Hello everyone, I'm Matt Mitrovich, the Alternate Historian, and welcome back to Warping History, where I discuss the history of the online alternate history community. Before I begin, let me first correct, clarify, and expand on a few things from the last episode. First off, I've been told that S.M. Sterling ran Ideas Through Soc.History.WhatIf, or SHWI, that later became his 2003 novel, Conquistador. Although not my favorite Sterling novel due to pacing issues, I do find the world building intriguing, and if you are a Sterling fan, you might enjoy it. Speaking of SHWI, I should have said that the Usenet group alt.history.whatif, or AHWI, didn't disappear immediately when SHWI appeared. It just sort of faded away and was considered a lesser alternate history Usenet group. My apologies, it's just that most sites even bothered to mention AHWI seemed to imply it fell apart rather quickly after SHWI showed up. Next, Andrew Smith told me on Facebook that Bithynig was the germ of Ilbesisad, and the vast majority of the world building was done by others. Apologies for implying otherwise, but it was always my intent to talk about the work of the other contributors in later episodes of Warping History. Finally, I've also been told that the name for self-published fan magazine is pronounced zine, not zine. In hindsight, that pronunciation makes sense, but to be honest, I've only ever read the word and never heard it out loud.
I wonder if I should check the comments from episode 1 to see if I missed anything. Anywho,
if Genie was the infancy of the alternate history community, and SHWI was its childhood, then alternatehistory.com was definitely the creepy teenage years. Now, there were other forums that sprung up alongside SHWI. Some notable examples include the aforementioned AHWI, the Alternate History Travel Guides, and the Yahoo group Alternate History, which gained a level of notoriety in 2011 when it was discovered that Tom McMaster's internet persona, Amina Abdallah Araf al-Amari, aka A Gay Girl in Damascus, posted there in 2006. None of these groups, however, could compare in size to what would become AlternateHistory.com, which was founded in September 2000 by Ian Montgomery, a software engineer from New York who originally hailed from Nova Scotia, as a way to solve the troll problem that plagued SHWI. As Ian put it, back when people could first buy internet domain names, I realized that speculators were going to buy up all the good ones for profit, so I decided to grab AlternateHistory.com on general principles. I asked the people of soc.history.whatif if they had any suggestions, and someone suggested creating a moderated discussion board. Usenet was unmoderated, and soc.history.whatif was experiencing some severe trolling, so it seemed like a logical idea. A small number of people joined it, and as it slowly grew, I did start moderating to keep out the worst trolls.
As people began migrating to alternatehistory.com, Ian noticed that it was a eccentric place.
The board in the early days was a lot friendlier and also a lot less serious than Usenet. Most people didn't put nearly as much effort into AH, partly because the audience for each work was a lot smaller. It was more of a casual discussion, coffeehouse sort of feel. Like many small communities, we discovered that small groups of people being quirky could have an impact on the culture of the entire board. A lot of early members were gay, and there was a religion about giant sheep.
FYI, the giant sheep religion is called sheepism, and according to my notes, it went through a schism, creating two branches, Orthodox sheepism and Reformed sheepism, because the internet.
Also, this was around the time that Mike Clevin, a notorious Wikipedia editor from Canada, was active on AlternateHistory.com, where he wrote about Canadian politics. He made headlines in 2013 for editing out criticism of Adrian Dix, former leader of the British Columbia New Democratic Party. To be honest, it's not terribly important, but I just thought it was a fun little moment where AlternateHistory.com was dragged into a political crisis. Anywho, AlternateHistory.com did not stay small, and today it's the largest gathering of alternate historians on the internet, and has, as I write this script, over 16 million posts and more than 36,000 registered members. Although, to be fair, most of those users probably aren't active, and Ian has estimated that the number is closer to 10,000, which is still pretty impressive. Some notable timelines to come out during this early period include Robert Perkins's The Black and the Gray, which was published in 2004 and featured the so-called Confederacy actually recruiting black soldiers during the 1861 Slaver Rebellion, leading to their victory at independence. Though controversial, especially for its pro-Southern leanings, it was rather popular on the board. Sadly, Robert passed away in 2012, but his fellow alternate historians would name an annual award after him in 2013, but more on those later. Robert also had his own personal website, as did many alternate historians in the early 2000s, who used free web hosting services like GeoCities to host their timelines. A unique feature of AlternateHistory.com was a directory, which linked to many of these sites, making the forum a central hub for alternate history on the web. Unfortunately, AlternateHistory.com dropped the directory to focus solely on a discussion forum. This, combined with the closure of GeoCities and other hosting services, meant that a lot of the online original alternate history from this era has become lost. But if you know where to look, you can still find it using the Wayback Machine.
Speaking of lost alternate history, with the arrival of alternatehistory.com, SHWI began to decline, but it didn't disappear overnight. In 2001, for example, Noel Maurer, and I'm sorry if I mispronounce your last name, posted the first Four Old Nails on SHWI. It was based on Robert Sobel's 1974 novel For Want of a Nail, an alternate history textbook set in a world where the Americans lost the Battle of Saratoga and remained a British colony, while the defeated rebels fled to Texas and eventually conquered Mexico. Other writers would add their own stories to the mix, creating a collaborative project that gained its own website and wiki. Unfortunately, by the present, SHWI became so full of spam bots that by April 2018, Google, which had become the new owner of the group, shut it down, officially ending one of the most influential alternate history groups on the internet. Meanwhile, alternatehistory.com was not the only new alternate history group to appear in the early 2000s. In 2002, Changing the Time was founded by Chris Nuttall, a British author and member of the Point of Divergence APA. Changing the Times was an online zine of alternate history that anyone could submit to in hopes of creating an internet archive. Changing the Times attracted some small attention from the alternate history community, but in 2006, it was temporarily replaced by a German porn site.
Come on, we've all been there.
After Nuttall solved that issue, he handed the reins of Changing the Times over to David Atwell, an Australian historian known for his online alternate histories and called one of the most prominent local counterfactualists, according to David Dale of the Sydney Morning Herald.
Changing the Times represented a trait that many online alternate historians share, which is that they're willing to self-publish their alternate histories for free.
Of course, not everyone gave away their work for free, but alternate historians had few publications dedicated solely to their favorite genre. That would change in 2003 when the first issue of Paradox, the magazine of historical and speculative fiction, was published by its editor, Christopher Savasco. Paradox featured short stories that, along with alternate history, included historical fiction, historical mysteries, historical fantasy, historical horror, time travel, Arthurian tales, and retold myths. The magazine also featured historical-themed poetry, reviews, and interviews with writers. Savasco was motivated to create Paradox by lack of places to publish historical short fiction, and stated, "Historical novels abound, but back in 2003, there was no print magazine exclusively dedicated to short historical fiction. Historical Now Society was publishing Salander biannually with a single story in each issue, and magazines such as FNSF, Asimov's, Realms of Fantasy, etc. occasionally featured alternate history, historical fantasy, or time travel stories, but Paradox provided the only magazine to which fans of these type of stories could turn for a regularly occurring fix."
Savasco said that 20% of all stories submitted to Paradox were alternate histories, and two of those stories were even nominated for the Sidewise Awards.
Alternate history's popularity, however, did not equal sales for Paradox. On May 12, 2009, Paradox published its last issue. While Savasco admitted that financial reasons were certainly a factor in Paradox's demise, he also thought the magazine was taking too much time away from his writing, and he wanted to focus on that. This wasn't, however, the end of professional magazines of alternate history fiction. The next year, Mark Lord published the first issue of Alt Hist, a magazine dedicated to publishing alternate history and historical fiction. Lord, like Savasco, was inspired to create Alt Hist because of the lack of publications available. Per Lord, "I thought there was a gap in the market, and also an opportunity to bring the speculative end of historical fiction, alternate history, and historical fantasy together with the mainstream end, something which I believe Paradox did very well." Unfortunately, Alt Hist wasn't that much more successful than Paradox, and on April 6, 2017, Alt Hist published their 10th and final issue, with Mark also citing a lack of time to focus on his own writing as the reason for shutting his magazine down.
While professional publications struggled to find a market for alternate history, the online community continued to grow and prosper.
The Brythonig Project's popularity increased as contributors fleshed out the world and created new constructed languages like Wendic, a Polish Romance language created in 2002. The first version of the Il Bestiaside Wiki was also created in 2003, which became the archive of information on the collaborative alternate history. A new community of alternate historians was also founded to rival the growing community at alternatehistory.com in 2002. Called Other Timelines, but also known by the name This Day in Alternate History, this collaborative community built timelines that could be explored by clicking on the site's calendar. Thus, multiple events from different alternate histories could be seen at once. Other Timelines' unique website even gained mainstream media attention from publications like the Houston Chronicle and the Philadelphia Inquirer.
Another community to rise during this time was the fandom for Eric Flint's 1632 series, where a West Virginia coal mining town is transported to the middle of Germany during the Thirty Years' War.
Since 1999, there had always been a large presence of 1632 fans located at the Baines Bar Forum, but it wasn't until 2003 when Dan Robinson founded 1632.org that this community began to organize itself. In that same year, the first Grantville Gazette was published, which included fan-written stories set in the 1632 universe. As explained by Grantville Gazette's editor Paula Goodlett, the Grantville Gazette first started as an experiment by Eric Flint and publisher Jim Bain.
fans just kept writing fanfics set in the 1632 universe and posting it to the Baines bar. Unlike many authors, Eric had no real problem with fanfic. Some of it was so good that he asked Jim Bain if an anthology of fanfic could be published. Jim agreed, and the first Ring of Fire anthology was published, with both fanfic and invited author stories. After that, fans were more inspired and kept writing. Then Granville Gazette 1 was published in paperback, which eventually led to Granville Gazette 2, 3, etc. The first five Gazettes were published in paper by Bain, exactly as the original ebooks were published. By the time we got to volume 6, there were too many online Gazettes to continue that, so we started publishing a Best Of volume in paper with volume 6. Thus, the 1632 expanding universe was born. Sometimes stories originally planned for release in the Granville Gazettes even received their own independent anthology, such as what happened in 2006 with 1634 The Ram Rebellion. As Paula explains, I'd just become the assistant editor, and we, me, the editorial board, and Eric, were getting Granville Gazette 3 ready for publication. That volume was intended to include most of the stories that wound up in 1634, The Ram Rebellion. Eric read the volume and decided, out of the blue, that many of those stories would fit into an anthology that covered land ownership laws in 17th century Germany, with a few additions from him and Virginia de Marche. So we rushed around selecting stories to fill the holes he left in volume 3, he wrote his story, and it all wound up being published as 1634, The Ram Rebellion. As Eric said at the time, here's a nice pile of shiny new monkey wrenches, and let's see what we can do with it. Very few alternate history authors approve of fanfiction like Flint, although S.M. Sterling does include fanfiction on his website and even introduced a character who originally appeared in a fanfiction in his 2008 novel Scourge of God. Speaking of Sterling, he plays a big role in the later half of the 2000s that will have a major impact in the online alternate history community, but I think I will save that for the next episode.
In the meantime, if you like what I do, please comment, subscribe, share this video, support me on Patreon. I'm Matt Mitrovich, the alternate historian. Bye!